longhouse community in New York was probably already disestablished, probably by the time of the Revolutionary War. And the longhouse community had communal gardens. All the Oneida people raised a lot of beans, and we still ate the same kind of food, the white corn and the beans and the squash. In the longhouse, the women tended the gardens and planted the seed, and the men cleared the fields, and they took down the trees and cleared a big field, and they did that work, the heavy duty work there. And then the women and children used hoes, and they tilled and they planted the fields of corn, beans, and squash, and other things. They had other vegetables too. According to Clinton and Sullivan's march through Iroquois country, when they Washington said to those generals, burn everything, burn the houses of the Iroquois, burn all their fields, destroy all their crops. And they found that there were like orchards in New York that were 1,500 trees in one orchard, peach and apple trees. And the soldiers kept diaries in Sullivan's army and said, we destroyed 1,500 trees today, chopped them down. And then they destroyed a cornfield that was 700 acres big that was related to the longhouse. I mean, it was Longhouse Village. There was a change in roles, too, of men and women. So now that when by the time they came to Wisconsin, the men were expected to be farmers and the women were expected to rear the children and take care of the house and do all, you know, all of that stuff. It wasn't like it was in the longhouse. And that had something to do with the churches as well, because the churches say, you know, that the man is the head of the house, and then that the women will do this. And that's taught in the churches. And they also, when they came here, they adapted from the people who lived here oxen. And that the Oneidas all either got one or two oxen, and they could do their lumbering with these animals, and they could do their tilling with these animals, but they could also be used as food as well. So there were a lot of oxen in this community when they first came, and then they changed gradually from oxen to horses. And then they did have milk cows, one or two, or how many they want. Sometimes they did get fairly large herds so that they could send milk off to a creamery or something. But that's the way it was from longhouse to log homes that were built here. And I think it was a very traumatic lifestyle change, very traumatic. But it took, you know, a while, like maybe 50 to 75 years to get from the longhouse to nuclear family, raising your own stuff. And the boarding schools also taught that in late 1800s, where it said that you should be an individual land owner and not do this community stuff, because that wasn't supposed to be the way it was. And so a lot of the students, and we had 500 that went to Carlisle in Pennsylvania, came back and said, you got to have these individual farms, and we got to do our own thing, and we've got to be selfish and earn as much money as we can for our own self, our own family, never mind this community stuff. Nevertheless, the Oneidas still went ahead with a lot of community functions, like building the church. That it was a community function. Some of the thrashing, the haying, and stuff like that they did in community groups. Threshing the grain was a community affair. Every farmer along the line that got threshed contributed one person at least, and maybe two, and they also contributed their team of horses to work with the threshing crew, that where you put the bundles on, and then you had to bring them up to the threshing machine, and then you had to haul oats or the wheat or the barley up to the granary. All farm families were like that. They never went hungry because they could utilize everything that they had in their cellar to make something very palatable, very tasty, and very nourishing. Another thing everybody did was visited after hours, and we thought that was the best thing, to listen to them talking about, you know, all the things, what kind of grain are you going to raise this year and this and that. It was a big discussion, and we had coffee and cake and all that stuff that goes on with visiting. We don't do that today. We don't know how to do it today. And I don't think it's going to take much to understand that. What it's going to take is the will to do it.
This is a program that provides education to the community. This is a program that provides our culture and some of the traditions through our white corn and our practices back to the community. We recognize that as a program, we're not this profit-driven decision maker. It's part of what we do, but it's not only what we do.
About 9 different varieties of bedding plants, which includes like broccoli, cauliflower, cabbages, usually a red and green. Sometimes we only grow one type. Then the main products are like a hot pepper, like a jalapeno, and a green pepper. And then the 3 different types of tomatoes. It'll be like a slicer, a canner, and a cherry tomato. So you get about 9 different types of bedding plants, and you get 4 of each variety. So 9 times 4 is 36. You're walking out of here with 36 plants. Well, the whole thing is knowing where your food comes from, or know your farmer, know your food, know what the value of your food is. Otherwise, who knows what people are putting on your food when they give it to you. There's a couple other programs within Tsynhehkwa that we do for the people. Is that if you have land and you don't have the machinery to work it up, we actually have a program, it's called rotivating, we call it. But it's like a rototiller that's hooked onto the back of a tractor. And for like $20 or $25, we'll go right out to your house, work up to a quarter of an acre for you. The other thing that we offer is a community garden site. And then we'll give you a plot. I think it's 20 by 30. And we'll actually till that up for you. And then you'll be able to go there and plant your plants. And then we have a container where we haul water on a regular basis. So that's another thing that we try to work with the people on.
We have a traditional harvest and husking bee. That's a cultural practice of the Oneida tribe. And it is a setup so that the community is involved in taking care of the white corn that you see. We have about 3 acres planted here in this particular field. And what we do is we invite the people to join us And part of that event, which we call the Harvest and Husking Bee, is a week long. We've been going from a Saturday till a Friday. The community comes out, but this particular day, we've had education days. And we either do it Monday through Wednesday or Monday through Thursday, depending on how many schools contact us. And we simply invite them to be a hands-on process of taking care of the white corn. So they get a chance to pick the corn, they're harvesting it, they're husking the corn, they're shelling some of the corn from last year's crop. They're your students and the people that are able to braid, they actually will be doing that process. So I think that's a big part of what gets them out here, is that we encourage them to participate and invite them. And to me, is what's so cool is that in these years, we've get these people coming on, especially the students, and really it's a grade school, and that's who's been here the last couple of days. You can see through this field how much they've covered, that they'll help us with these 3 acres, and if this happens to get done, we have another 3 acres of corn in a lower field.
The opportunity we have in Oneida to work in collaboration as a team with our environmental department, our agricultural department, our land use department, gives us a golden opportunity to do safe practices or long-term investment in the soil so it stays fertile or it moves back to its natural, potent, vibrant, life-giving self. Along with conservation efforts and legal efforts and water quality and agricultural practices and watershed science and large staffs of Oneida people that work towards those goals, we can stay in touch and be wise, not just in agriculture, not just in culture, not just in science. It takes a lot of heads, a lot of wisdom, a lot of counsel to come up with a long-term plan for land use.
So when we made the decision, whether we have the organic certification or not, we would follow these natural practices. We don't use pesticides, herbicides. We try and be very mindful of what we're doing to the land. An example with the corn is that we do rotational planting. So this field will not be used again. It's about 3 acres for another 3 years. So we'll plant it in the lower field. We're giving that land a chance to replenish itself, to heal itself from growing the corn. We'll be back up here.
We do workshops. So it's not only just on gardening, but there's also a Three Sisters, we call it a Three Sisters workshop, which is the corn, beans, and squash. We use the white corn, and we like to use the Hubbard squash. And then it has to be some type of a pole bean. Whether I use two main types of pole beans. One is we call it a bear bean, which is similar to a scarlet runner. And the other one we call a Ganawage bean, which is it's a Mohawk pole bean. They're in a symbiotic relationship. So what it is we plant the corn first, and when it gets maybe this tall, we'll put a bean next to that. The bean actually will provide nitrogen, take nitrogen right out of the air and put it into the ground. And then the corn will feed off that nitrogen. And then the corn provides a trellis for the bean, and the bean will actually end up wrapping itself around that corn stalk and growing up it. Mostly we use our own cattle manure from our Galloway beef. That's our main source of fertilization for our white corn, but we also use some of it for our garden area. But then also when the corn is up in the three leaf stage, it's really very small yet, and we'll apply what's called liquid fish. And so that's another natural type of fertilizer that we use as well, and that works really well. We had a pretty decent year for our corn compared to a lot of people I've seen, you know, further south. Their corn maybe got 3-4 feet high. We still had our normal 10-12 foot tall corn stalks. Other things we do is we have organic chickens that we raise here. We do a couple runs per year. They're usually 100 to 125 per batch. But what we do is we sell those to community members, and I sell them all ahead of time before the first one's even harvested. And we sell them for $3 a pound. And depending on the weight of each bird individually, that's how we charge you. By the way, those chickens are all certified organic. We have laying hens that we have brown eggs, and they're Rhode Island Reds. We also sell those eggs to the public. Another thing we do is called grass-fed beef. We have a variety called Galloway, and they're very hardy in the winter. We don't really have to even bring them in the winter months. We do let them, we open the door so they can go in the barn if they want to, but most of them don't even want to go in the barn. We have a new place called Oneida Market that just opened up, And so what we've been doing is we just started doing cuts. So you can buy hamburger or your steaks or roast or different things like this. And it's very healthy meat for you.
This is my sanctuary. We come down, you can actually see what you produce every day and the good that it does in the community. We do corn here. You know, we do the grass-fed beef there. We use, everything is organic and fertilized, but it's also a place of peace and solitude. People will come out here and work. We do a lot of work with community service workers. And to a person, every person that comes out here say, this is great, how can I get hired here, you know? We get a lot of people that come out and volunteer for us. Almost every Native community across the nation, it's like, how do we decolonize our lands? It's very important that we keep this. When we talk about traditional knowledge and cultural knowledge, we do have to know what we're talking about because it's very important. I took some of our dried corn from here as gift. We had a ceremony up there. The person that was running the ceremony, we gifted him what we could with our maple sugar, with our corn. They have more wild rice than us. But we also gave him some trade goods there. So it wasn't a monetary thing. And they understood that. That's a traditional way of doing that. You give the goods of the earth that you can. You know, you don't have to run to Walmart to do that. And the best thing I think that we did is we shared what we could of those good feelings. And to me, this is what this place does for me.
As a program, we are reliable on the Oneida Tribe of Wisconsin. They basically take care of our budget. Right now, we've done 6 acres for the last few years because we've kind of recognized how much corn can we handle? How much are we able to process? We hand harvest the corn. And that's a lot of acreage in corn to not only hand harvest the husk, to dry down, but then the shell, it's hand shell. I'm looking at it from the direction of the program, a gradual growth of 6 acres now, 2.8, 2.10, but then start factoring all those decisions in is, okay, where are you going to store that corn? That's a lot of acreage to take care of, regardless if we have the machine or not. How are you going to process that corn? And during storage phases, when you're drying it down, there's one section. When it has to be shelled, that's another section. And for our corn, the best way to store it is actually in a freezer. So where do you have a freezer that you can walk in and store that much corn that can handle it safely and you maintain?
And the other thing that comes with that is the moisture content. So we have to actually dry that down. That's why I've been talking about all this drying down of corn that we're doing right now. We have to actually dry that down to 12% moisture content before we can store it or start shelling it. We've put it in a big corn crib. And because our corn is so wet, we try to dry it down that way, but because our moisture content is so high or our corn is so wet, it'll actually start sprouting and molding before it gets a chance to dry down. So now we have a moisture tester, and we've learned to test the corn so it's down to 12% before we actually shell it and store it. This actually type of corn goes back to our creation story, so it's always been in our life, and we're trying to keep that moving forward so it's in our people's life forever.
There's not always that monetary value applied to a work or a product or a value from the monetary sense to it of those cultures, of those traditions. When we look at this equipment, I'm concerned that people start making that decision then, well, let's plant 100 acres. That way, if we lose so much, it's okay because we have all this back oven. But this hand harvesting part is part of our culture. this hand harvesting and shelling part is part of the traditions and the community building. Now, maybe we necessarily won't hand harvest all 6 acres anymore, or 8 or 10 where we go to our shell it, but we'll always do it. And that's an important aspect to apply that to this kind of program today, as well as in future growth.
One thing I give the credit to our modern leadership for is we will stand up for that, because we know without this creation and the rest of our relatives, we're not going to be able to survive. And that is the basis, you know, of all those teachings that came back. We only walk this world for a very short time, and then we're gone. And what do we leave for those that come after? Our ancestors were enlightened enough to keep it for us, you know, through some very harsh times, and we should be able to know enough to keep it for those that are coming.
Each cob is a different story.
We're the organic conscience. We are a tried and true organic practices, but it also seems that we're allowed a little more respect when we make decisions about land. The majority of people around us seem to take notice. What are the Indians doing? We sometimes can be a leader just because of our heritage of balance and caring for the land. So we still have a large legal and scientific department, but it's a bonus when it starts becoming a political or public relations matter for river cleanup or mining or whatever it happens to be. When Native Americans get involved, there seems to be a strong credential for we know why they're doing it.
To me, the whole idea isn't about trying to get top dollar. It's more trying to get the healthy food back into the community. Of course, we have to make some money at it, and so we can break even, basically. We're branching out now and doing other things like this Oneida Market, and that's really a good thing. It's a really high visibility, a good location. And then with our cuts, I can see on our different corn products as well, you can see there's a lot higher volumes of sales now that we've moved a little bit towards into the city. So a little bit, catching a little bit of that urban area.
We help people come in who want to process their products, whatever they're making. Some people do not know how to process their food, and we are certified. I did a lot of canning with my mother, and to me it's more of like a homemade. Homemade is better. There's no preservatives in your food. It's all natural. If you want sugar, you can add sugar. If you don't want sugar, you don't need sugar. And we do have products that we have that are certified. So we communicate with the Brown County Extension Office also. Right now it's apple season, so they're going to want to come in and do applesauce, apple pie filling, dried apple chips with cinnamon on them, apple butter. We just recently got done with tomatoes. Tomatoes was just passed like 2 weeks ago. And then before that was pickles and cucumbers and bread and butter pickles. And now it's salsas. We're still got a little bit of tomatoes left, so we're doing salsas, red salsa and green salsa. And we also make our corn products with the corn that is out here in the field. And we do ganestoha, which is a corn bread, and that's made out of the corn flour. And we use wood ash, boil that down, take the hull off, grind it, and then dehydrate it for about 4 hours, then grind it and then make it into the flour. We also do corn berry mush, which is the raw corn. Put it in the oven for 350, 20 minutes first batch, then you move it around so it gets nice and brown, and another 20 minutes, so it's about 40 minutes. So we make 10 different products out of the corn. Throughout the year, we'll do a workshop, a beef jerky workshop, which is scheduled for November, I believe. So we try to get 3 or 4, maybe 5 workshops in a year. But I enjoy the camaraderie, the getting together, the family being together, because anyone from 14 on up can come to the cannery and can with their parents, as long as their parents are there. We are there to assist you, but you're the one in essence who is actually doing the work. We just help you do the work. And then we process the food so it's safe, so we know it's safe.
You know, in the future, I'd like to see, you know, the young people learning, coming over and learning how to work with Tsynhehkwa and learning how to work with the land. There's, you know, we have to get into the schools and teach those young people so that they know about this growing up.
We're given a responsibility to be almost like automatic caretakers of the land. And we need to live up to that, of course. Luckily, at the table, the stakeholders are woodland conservation people, fishery people, water quality people, so we can make some good, balanced, and informed decisions about how this Oneida Reservation is going to look for the next 100 years or so.